Welcome back, everybody. You all should know who I am by now, especially since the channel name tells you who I am. But in case you suffered a traumatic brain injury between videos, I am Mr. P, and today we'll hopefully be wrapping up the response to the Reddit thread that we began last time. Just a quick reminder to like, share, subscribe, smack the notification bell, blah, blah, blah. You know the drill. Last time, we made it all the way through about two-thirds of the first sentence of the two-sentence horror story that prompted all this. Not as far as I wanted to get, and yet, somehow I'm not surprised I only got that far. Anyway, we discussed the nature of what happens after death as far as standing in front of some scribe is concerned, and then we discussed the claims about the father getting into heaven simply because he died as a Christian. Is that a meaningful statement in itself, or is it utterly meaningless without further qualification? What does it even mean to be a Christian in the first place, and does it go beyond simply claiming to be one? If you haven't listened to that one, I would recommend going back and checking it out. It's only about half an hour, which is what I've been trying to keep most of these to. Today, we'll begin by looking at the remainder of sentence one, which says that the daughter is in hell because she lost her faith because of what her father did to her. Something we also addressed in the last video. After going over biblical examples of people who were saved after doing atrocious things, the Apostle Paul being probably the best example, the conclusion was that it was no more unfair for the father to be saved and go to heaven than anyone else is saved and goes to heaven. If there was actual criminal activity that took place, he should face the consequences for that according to the legal system, but that has no bearing on whether or not God can forgive him any more than Christ forgave the man that was being executed next to him for a capital offense. Nobody is deserving of salvation, which is why it is an act of grace. Grace that can be demanded, or even disqualified, is not grace. So, if it isn't unfair or even unjust for this father to be saved after doing terrible things, is it fair for the daughter to go to hell for losing her faith because of what was done to her? Well, again, we need to try to look at this as objectively as possible. We cannot like what the Bible says about certain things, but that doesn't change the message or the standard.
No, don't like that.
If you're listening to this and you're a Christian, then the standard is what God says, not what we feel. Remember, sin has influenced everything about us, even our thinking and feelings about things like God's wrath and justice against sin. We are to conform ourselves to His standards, not try to drag Him down to ours. If we do, then we commit idolatry by fashioning God after our own image and worshiping that rather than how He has actually revealed Himself. So, with that in mind, how then do we handle this? Well, put bluntly, apostasy and the rejection of the faith is a sin. There is no getting around this. Look at the book of Hebrews. For it is impossible, in the case of those who have once been enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come and then have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they again crucified themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame. For ground that drinks the rain, which often falls on it, and produces vegetation useful to those for those whose sake it is also tilled, receives a blessing from God. But if it yields thorns and thistles, it is worthless and close to being cursed, and it ends up being burned. Hebrews 6, 4-8. For if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has ignored the law of Moses is put to death without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severe punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God, and has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified, and has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," and again, "The Lord will judge his people." It is a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Hebrews 10, 26-31. See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many become defiled, that there be no sexually immoral or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. For you know that even afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought for it with tears. Hebrews 12:15-17. Time and time again, the author of Hebrews warns of the dangers of apostasy and the judgment such individuals will endure. He also speaks of the idea that it is likely impossible that such a person will ever return to the faith in the first place. Now, I tend to think there is a difference here between someone who leaves the faith having simply grown up in it but never made any profession to believe it, over against someone who professed Christ and had been apparently living accordingly for some time, only to later abandon it. In other words, this is the difference between people who grew up in a Christian home and then just quit going to church saying, "I never really believed any of it," versus someone who deconstructs and apostatizes later in life after having served in the church and may have even preached the gospel at one time. I believe it is the latter group the author of Hebrews is speaking of. In fact, there is a video I plan on doing at some point going over one of these deconstruction testimonies, which is really just a fancy word for apostatizing. But people use the term because it makes them sound more intellectual. Sadly, most of the reasons people give for apostasy are anything but intellectual, but mostly emotional. All of that said, there is another passage that comes to mind when we talk about apostasy, and that, of course, is found over in 1 John. "They went out from us, but they were not really of us. For if they had been of us, they would have remained with us, but they went out so that it would be evident that they all are not of us." This is an argument that a lot of people, especially those who have walked away from the faith, really don't like to hear. John argues in this epistle nothing different from what Christ himself taught. True faith is that which not only comes from God and is revealed to us and given to us by God, but it is also that which produces results. True faith produces spiritual fruit. As I explained in the video on salvation and even the first part of this response, faith produces genuine evidence of that faith. That said, the New Testament writers never once rule out the possibility of false professions of faith, or even that people may outwardly conform to Christian principles for one reason or another. These people think they are saved, they go through the motions, but their inward desires are not truly aligned with God. They may conform because it was what they grew up with. They may conform because they are looking for social acceptance and have joined a church looking for a sense of community. This last one is actually a major problem in churches today, since many are nothing more than religious social clubs that don't actually stand for anything grounded in scripture. This is something I'll discuss whenever I get around to the deconstruction video I mentioned earlier. Now, this isn't to say that having support from believers or continuing in the faith in which one was raised is a bad thing. Those are frequently mechanisms used by God to strengthen believers. The very idea of a cohesive body of believers is taught throughout scripture, and believers are never told not to be a part of a local church. However, as good as those things are, they are not a substitute for genuine repentance, genuine change of heart, and genuine faith. The parable of the sower is an excellent illustration of how different people respond to the gospel. It is found in all three of the Synoptic Gospels in Matthew 13, Mark 4, and Luke 8. For time's sake, I'll be using the version found in Matthew 13. The wording across all three accounts is more or less the same with varying levels of word count. Fortunately, Christ gives and explains the parable, so I don't have to. "And he told them many things in parables, saying, 'Behold, the sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and the birds came and ate them up. Others fell on the rocky places where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up immediately because they had no depth of soil. But after the sun rose, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Others fell among the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. But others fell on the good soil and yielded a crop, some 100, some 60, and some 30 times as much. The one who has ears, let him hear." Listen then to the parable of the sower. "When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is the one sown with seeds beside the road. The one sown with seed on the rocky places, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no firm root in himself, but is only temporary, and when affliction or persecution occurs because of the word, immediately he falls away. And the one sown with seed among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, and the anxiety of the world and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. But the one sown with seed on the good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100, some 60, and some 30 times as much. Matthew 13:3-9 and 18-23. The first three types of seed are those that we would identify as false believers or temporary believers. The same type of thing happens in John 8 when the people were believing in Jesus and by the end of the chapter are wanting to stone him. Notice the descriptions Christ gives. You have the one where the gospel has no effect because Satan immediately exudes his influence to kill any reception whatsoever. The third one is someone who may have accepted it but was discouraged from doing so because of their desire for wealth and acclaim. They don't want to deal with the sacrifice involved in serving. The second and fourth are the two that are most pertinent for our discussion here. The second seed springs up and looks like things are going well, but its roots aren't firmly established. In other words, there is no real grounding for the seed. In the Matthean version, Jesus describes them as falling away because of affliction or persecution because of the word. Luke provides a slightly different phrasing. Those on the rocky soil are the ones who, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and yet, these do not have a firm root. They believe for a while, and in a time of temptation, they fall away. Luke 8:13. The word temptation there is certainly fitting for what both Matthew and Mark describe as testing and adversity. The point is that these individuals look like there is life in them and seem to be growing, but when true adversity and testing comes, they wither. This could be personal attacks from others, or it could be societal pressure. It is not uncommon to hear people say that they left the faith because they didn't like how conservative Christianity handles issues of social justice. Frequently, it turns out they had a friend that was involved in prohibited behavior, and they just couldn't handle the idea of actually having to follow what Scripture says about certain things because it might hurt their friendship. They may want to feel accepted by academia, and so they start throwing out an orthodox view of Scripture as inspired. I think there's certainly some overlap that can happen between seeds 2 and 3, but the point remains that the roots were never firmly established. These people walk away because they never truly believed in the first place, let alone had any firm reasoning for why they believed in the first place. In fact, when you really listen, it's not uncommon to hear certain phrases and cues that indicate this individual already had a problem with Christianity in the first place and was looking for a way out. This is why I've heard so many stories and objections that people had that led them out of Christianity that just leave me stunned and asking, how was nobody able to answer that for you? These sort of things have been answered and dealt with for centuries. How could you not find anything that even remotely began to answer that? The fact of the matter is, if you want to find an excuse not to do something, you'll find everything in the world to give you that confirmation bias. To be fair, we're all guilty of doing it to some extent or the other. However, there needs to be discernment and a willingness to be corrected. In my experience, with a lot of these people, it doesn't matter what you say. They don't want to hear a truly biblical response. They've made up their mind before they ever started deconstructing. In contrast, notice what is said about the fourth type of seed. But the one sown with seed on the good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100, some 60, and some 30 times as much. Matthew 13:23. Only one type of seed actually produces results. It is the one who hears, understands, meaning they accept and believe it, and then produces fruit. Again, this is the same thing Jesus speaks of in John 15 when he says that those who truly abide in him as a vine does a branch will produce fruit, and those who do not are cut off and cast into the fire. John 15:1-6. True faith is what gives us the ability to endure even when things are going horribly wrong. As Paul wrote to the church at Rome, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we also have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we celebrate in hope of the glory of God. And not only this, but we also celebrate in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance, and perseverance, proven character, and then proven character, hope. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us." Romans 5:1-5. Keep in mind, this is a person who endured persecution, shipwreck, stoning, and ultimately death for the sake of the gospel. Paul understood a thing or two about suffering for the cause of Christ. Here, he says that Christians rejoice in times of tribulation because we know that coming through it strengthens us and helps us to endure. James says the same thing at the beginning of his epistle. "Consider it all joy, my brothers and sisters, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." James 1:2-4. Neither Paul, nor James, or even Christ for that matter, ever said that life as a Christian would be free from hardship. Anyone who has ever claimed otherwise has been lying. The Christian life is no more free from hardship and difficulty than anyone else. And in some cases, it's even worse, because we are called to live lives that run counter to what our nature would compel us to do. It is a daily task of submitting our wills to God's. Nothing Paul went through minimizes the traumatic experiences of what the fictitious daughter went through. There are certainly times when horrible things happen that cause people to stumble in their faith. The prodigal son would be an example of this. The son goes out, wastes his life on riotous living, and ultimately realizes the damage he has done. He returns to his father and repents and asks for forgiveness. At no point did the son swear off being a son or ever stop being a son. There was a time he wandered away, but he returned. He didn't curse his father's name and swear never to return. This isn't analogous to outright apostasy. The point is that for whatever reason, he decided he wanted to do his own thing, only to realize what a waste it was. Christians may undergo hardships, and some may even say, "You know, this service thing isn't really working for me. Sure, I'll still go to church, but I just can't do the rest of it." However, if their faith truly was genuine, and they truly are a child of God, this won't go on permanently. As Hebrews states, "You have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood in your striving against sin, and you have forgotten the exhortation which is addressed to you as sons. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you are punished by him. For whom the Lord loves, he disciplines, and he punishes every son whom he accepts. It is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you are without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, so that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems not to be pleasant, but painful. Yet, to those who have been trained by it, afterward, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness." Hebrews 12:4-11. A child may walk away in disobedience, but that child will always be disciplined and brought back to a right relationship with God. If that discipline does not take place, it means they were never truly a son or daughter. In principle, it's the same thing John said over in 1 John 2:19, as we saw earlier. So let's get back to the story. The daughter is in hell because she lost her faith because of what her father did. Well, more than likely, the father was never truly a Christian, but even if he converted later on, that doesn't absolve the daughter's sin of apostasy and faithlessness. Yes, faithlessness is a sin. As Paul says to Rome, For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of people who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them. For God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, that is, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived, being understood by what has been made, so that they are without excuse. Romans 1, 18-20. If someone is considered without excuse for rejecting the very concept of a divine creator from the evidence presented in creation, how much worse is it for those who have even greater revelation and having expressed faith in God and in his Son, only to renounce it later and abandon it altogether? There is even greater judgment at that point. In fact, to have that much revelation and then reject it is to essentially call God a liar, saying that not only does he not really exist, but that everything he supposedly revealed to man through creation and his word is a lie. If they are without excuse due to nature, they are with even less excuse for rejecting divine revelation. Even when bad things happen to us, we are still responsible for how we respond to them. The underlying assumption in the story seems to be that the daughter lost her faith in God because of the betrayal by her father. Essentially, if God is real, why did this bad thing happen? The question is never, why do bad things happen to good people? Because from a biblical perspective, there are no good people. Remember, we are all born the enemies of God due to Adam's fall and the sin nature that is passed to all of us. The question is, why does God show grace and mercy to anyone at all? Why does God choose to save anyone instead of giving us all justice? If the father is responsible for his actions, the daughter is responsible for hers too. Let's say, for example, the father did become a true Christian later on, as discussed in the last video. It is still the responsibility of the daughter to truly repent of her sins and truly place her faith in Christ as well. It is irrelevant what happened to her as far as that is concerned. It doesn't suddenly make her not culpable for every other sin she has ever committed in life. Unbelief is just one more to add to the pile. I do want to say one thing here just real quick. I am in no way unsympathetic to someone who goes through something like this. I've known people who have been through this sort of thing, and it is a very common story to hear someone enduring tragedy and heartache, and it led them down the path of apostasy. It seems to me that Hebrews is being quite literal when it says that it is impossible to renew these people to repentance. There may be something I'm missing when the author uses that phrase, but then he speaks about not re-crucifying Christ and putting Christ to shame. Calvin describes it this way. He also adds this to defend God's severity against the calumnies of men. For it would be wholly unbecoming that God, by pardoning apostates, should expose his son to contempt. They are then wholly unworthy to obtain mercy. But the reason why he says that Christ would thus be crucified again is because we die with him for the very purpose of living afterwards a new life. When, therefore, any return as it were unto death, they have need of another sacrifice, as we will find in the 10th chapter. Crucifying for themselves means as far as in them lies, for this would be the case, and Christ would be slandered as it were triumphantly were it allowed men to return to him after having fallen away and forsaken him. Some might ask then how such a passage would apply to Peter, who denied Christ. Well, Peter did so out of fear of being arrested and suffering the same fate as Christ. It was basically just words to avoid getting in trouble. Put simply, he said it out of cowardice, not because he actually rejected Christ and had no faith in him. It's not the same as what we're talking about here. Still, the point is this. Even when someone goes through something horrific and truly apostatizes, we are not to glory in that or to feel anything other than sorrow for that person. Again, this is dealing with true rejection of Christ and everything he is, not someone simply being disobedient for a while. To be quite honest, we don't actually know for certain what condition someone is in. A child can get angry at his parents and say, "I hate you," but not actually mean it. I would also say that in some of these cases of people who have walked away, they have been hurt but don't truly wish to abandon the faith. They're still in disobedience, sure, but it's not a total and final rejection of Christ. Again, we aren't given that level of insight into someone's heart, so on an intellectual level, it's easy to say that, based on the story here, the daughter was never truly a believer, since a true child of God will always return to him because true faith comes from God and perseveres. In a real-world situation where we don't know what the end result will be, we have to be very careful. The moment someone appears to walk away from the faith, we need to keep in mind that they are either simply prodigal, or they could very well be apostate. Only time will tell. In the meantime, we do the same thing we should do for everyone else. We show the love of Christ for them by meeting their needs, praying for them, showing kindness and grace to them, and declaring the gospel. We don't turn our backs on them and speak condemnation to them. We call them to return back in repentance, but we do so out of a genuine love for them and the desire to see them grow and flourish and experience the blessings of God. So, all of that to say this, is it fair for the daughter to be in hell? Absolutely. Why? Because she is responsible to repent and believe, just as all of us are. If she apostatized, it shows that her faith was never truly grounded as per the parable of the sower, and she will be judged accordingly. Traumatic experiences do not absolve us of our guilt before God. Unbelief is just one more sin to add to the list. All of us are in the exact same position as rebel sinners before God, bound for hell, and there but for the grace of God go any one of us. We are all held to the same standard and all answer to God for ourselves, not for someone else. Is that something comfortable to say? No. Does it pull at the heartstrings and make us feel emotionally that this isn't fair? Of course it does. The entire story is designed to say, if this makes you feel bad, then it means that it is bad. However, that assumes our standard of what is right and wrong is correct. From a Christian perspective, we conform our standards to God's. This leads to the second sentence, which won't take long to discuss. You'll recall that the woman in the story gets ready to protest, but then she's essentially brainwashed or something to not care. The idea is that she had to be made to feel like this wasn't an injustice to stop her from protesting, almost like God had to blind her to his injustice and cover up his misdeeds. Of course, this is a gross misrepresentation of what Scripture teaches. First, we already established the scenario itself as bogus, since we don't stand before some scribe when we die in the first place, but even the rest of it is utter nonsense. Remember, from a Christian perspective, sin has corrupted everything about us, including our thought processes and what we perceive as right and wrong. It is the purpose of divine revelation to give us a thorough guide and set of principles on which to base our ethics and morality. Now, people will claim they don't need God to do this, but Christian ethicists and apologists have argued for quite some time now that nobody claims you don't need God to have a conscience or to have some sort of concept of right and wrong. That's not the claim. Everyone has a conscience, and we say that was designed by God to guide us. However, that has been tainted, and so our conscience doesn't always tell us something is wrong when it is. Many people convince themselves that what they're doing is right all the time when it's objectively wrong. The argument is that not only do you need an ultimate authority to help correct your standards of right and wrong, but that without any objective standard, your view of what is right and wrong is meaningless, and therefore there is no reason to call anyone else to hold to that standard, since it all boils down to personal preference anyway. I digress. The point I'm getting at is that the idea of, if this makes you feel bad, then it means that's because it is terribly subjective, since not everyone obviously feels the same way. Emotional response to something isn't the way to validate or invalidate an ethical standard. With that said, let's get back to the story itself. Do we really expect God to have to dose us all with massive amounts of copium in order to make us happy in paradise, because otherwise we would see God as a monster? Well, the skeptic would say, yes, that's exactly the case. However, Scripture has a slightly different take on it. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is, 1 John 3:2. Incidentally, all of 1 John 3 deals with the idea that those who are truly born of God do not live lives characterized by sin. I feel like we've heard that before a few other places. The point being made here in verse 2 is that when Christ returns, we will be like him. We know from other passages, such as 1 Corinthians 15, that this means when Christ returns, we will be finally freed from the corrupting effects of sin and have a new glorified body. Behold, I am telling you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable puts on the imperishable, and this mortal puts on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, "Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ," 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 57. All of this together, the idea is this. When Christ returns, or if we die first and earn his presence in eternity, we will no longer be corrupted by sin, which means we will be able to fully recognize our sin for what it is. We will also have a proper perspective of the righteousness and justice of God and an even deeper understanding for the mercy and grace he has shown us. This isn't because God is flooding us with divine drugs or anything. It is the result of having sin fully removed from us, finally having the blinders taken off, so to speak. Now, I also want to take the time to mention that this does not mean that suddenly we have an overwhelming joy over the fate of the damned. This is somehow another misrepresentation that God just gets sick pleasure out of torturing the condemned. There is an aspect of this that is true, but let me explain. When we say that God receives glory and delights in the punishment of the wicked, and yet at the same time doesn't delight in it, we aren't saying God is schizophrenic. For example, we celebrate and we rejoice when a murderer is convicted of his crime and sentenced to death. Why? Because justice is being served. However, we are not celebrating the events that led to the need for such punishment. Nobody rejoices over the fact that someone had been murdered just so we could see justice done. We all would rather that the crime never happened in the first place. Nor do we celebrate the fact that another life needs to be taken as an expression of justice and warning to others who would do the same crime. We mourn and we regret the loss of life in both cases, but we recognize, at least those of us who believe in capital punishment anyway, that the murderer has forfeited his life due to his actions. So, in the same way, God rejoices and is glorified when his divine justice against sin is demonstrated, but he does not take pleasure in the fact that someone has to be brought to justice because of what they did. When we are finally free from sin and its corrupting influence, we will recognize and glory in God's justice while also not celebrating the fact that evil had taken place, leading to the need for that justice. Now, this of course is where you get into the discussion of the origin of evil and the justification of God, known as theodicy, but that's a different video for another day. And to summarize, it is fair for both the father to later become a Christian, assuming that's what the story was even implying, because salvation is an act of grace, and it is also fair for the daughter to be punished for her unbelief, because the rejection of Christ is also a sin, and she remains rightfully condemned as a sinner, as all mankind is, so long as they remain outside of Christ. However, this assumes the father ever truly was a Christian and not simply one in name only. If he is, then the story fails to properly present the fact that even he would be in hell, because simply claiming Christian affiliation is meaningless outside of genuine repentance and faith. the father would be in the same position as the daughter, and both would be condemned. The mother would not have reason to protest because she would have a proper understanding of what it means to see the justice and mercy of God displayed, with justice against sin and mercy for those who are brought to faith in Christ. She would mourn the sin that required such justice, but she would also understand that justice needs to be fulfilled, and would see the execution of that justice as right, because she would no longer have the corrupting influence of sin manipulating her thoughts through her emotions. Again, emotional response is not an indicator of whether or not something is moral. Also, though I've already said it, just because something appears to be a certain way to us does not mean we know for certain whether someone has walked away temporarily in disobedience or has fully apostatized. That is between them and God, and only time will tell which is which. In the meantime, we continue to show the love of Christ for them, show kindness to them, pray for them, and call them to repentance and love. Incidentally, this last part is the most loving thing we can do, considering that, from a Christian perspective, their soul is at stake. Remember, Paul was willing to suffer damnation for his own people if it were possible to see them come to Christ. I think we can manage at least a little bit of effort to speak the gospel and love to them.
And I've always said, you know, that I don't respect people who don't proselytize. I don't respect that at all. If you believe that there's a heaven and hell, and people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think that, well, it's not really worth telling them this because it would make it socially awkward. And atheists who think that people shouldn't proselytize, just leave me alone, keep your religion to yourself. How much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate somebody to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? I mean, if I believed beyond a shadow of a doubt that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe it, that truck was bearing down on you, there's a certain point where I tackle you. And this is more important than that.
Anyway, that should do it for me. I think next time we'll deal with some of the comments on the thread, and then that should wrap it up for the series. As always, if you benefited from this, or if you learned anything beneficial from it, be sure to share it with someone else. In the meantime, take care of yourselves, and I'll talk to you again soon.